Well, hello. The name's Cal Carl Cartwright. A lot of work to be done if we're going to get this place fixed up. Welcome to ye old house. Welcome to Glitter Void Gamecraft. My name is actually Eric, and today I am building a smattering of furniture to furnish all the buildings that I've built so far. This is it, the step that will take your interior playable buildings from, oh, that's cool, the roof comes off, to your players are now fighting over which room in the inn they get because, holy crap, that bed is so freaking cute. The best thing about these is they are infinitely reusable, and you don't need too many of them to be able to furnish the entire city, because how many individual pieces are they actually going to see in any one encounter? Naturally, this is going to be sort of a recurring series as I continue to add buildings to the Fantasy Starter Village, and the need for other pieces of furniture arises, I will have another video where I make whatever I need for that. Towards the end of the video, I'll give you some ideas of ways to use this furniture at the table. You know, other than, of course, as the furniture it's meant to be. But for now, let's saw some fingers off.
No need for a plan here. I'm just gonna use mostly dollar store foam core board to make the various planks and boards needed to furnish the farmhouse and the chapel. When making the components, it's even more important than ever to make clean cuts by taking multiple passes with the knife. There's not gonna be layers of detail to hide any torn edges of the foam, and more of each plank will be visible. For most of these accessories, the measurements aren't really important as long as it makes sense with the minis you're using. I picked a miniature and cut the supports of the table accordingly. I've tried a few times to make tables with proper legs, but they tend to end up being too spindly and weak, or the legs are so big that they look odd. This isn't furniture for a true-to-life diorama, it's play pieces to create interest, hiding places, or makeshift weapons. Flat supports on each end keep it stable and prevent the pieces from being top-heavy. Using hot glue for these accessories runs the risk of being messier, but I wanted to get the basic construction done in one sitting, and PVA glue takes too long to dry. I went slow and controlled and cleaned up any overflowing glue as I went. For my exaggerated wood grain textures, there's basically two types. The lines meant to imply the space between two separate boards and the actual grain of the wood itself. The board lines are generally deeper and or wider, though not enough to cut through or weaken the foam. These should be continued past the edges and at least a bit of attention paid to their number and direction on pieces where you can see both sides of the wood. Though I seriously doubt anyone is likely to pick up your pretend table and start counting slats on both sides. The wood grain takes a lighter touch, just scratching the surface, and is much more wavy. And make sure to do the ends of each board as well. I go back and forth on whether to texture or assemble pieces like this first. Sometimes it's easier to do the wood grain first, for instance if a lot of the surfaces are hard to reach, like a bookshelf. But on some pieces, doing the grain after assembly makes it easier to figure out the aesthetics of the board placement, so all your lines are traveling in a way that makes sense. The cabinet is one place where I measured more precisely. I wanted it to have an overhang at the top and the bottom, so the space it occupied on the ground was no more than one square deep and two wide. As I was putting this together, I noticed that the cabinet was super top heavy. I solved this by pouring hot glue inside to add weight before I attached the top piece. I tried to get as little as possible on the sides, so all the weight would be as low as possible. I made two sizes of beds, a single and a double sized mattress. Both are a take on DM Scotty's simple beds, a link to his full video in the description. The large one I made with all foam core, making sure the headboard and footboard extended beneath the base of the bed to function as legs. For the single bed, I wanted to try using the ends of a jumbo popsicle stick as a head slash footboard, since it was already curved. This would make the bed a little small, but maybe it's a gnome or halfling size bed. I eyeballed the sizes and marked the ends, then scored the stick with my knife. After a few gouging passes, the ends could be snapped off, leaving a perfectly straight and clean line. I added a wood grain texture to the wooden pieces, that's a strange bit of sentence, using my knife, and hot glued it to the base. The smaller end broke when texturing, but I just finished up the fragments and glued the pieces in place. The base had a little bit of overhang, so I used the edges of the head and footboard as a jig to cut it off. For the sheets, I doubled over some toilet paper and trimmed it to fit the mattresses, wrapping it all the way around. I initially tried to secure it in place with hot glue, but since that doesn't seep through the toilet paper, I would have had to glue each layer separately. Instead, once everything was in place, I sprayed on a mixture of PVA glue and water. While it was still wet, I manipulated the sheet as best I could. Another good reason not to use hot glue. Setting those to dry in front of a box fan shortened the drying time to about an hour. Then I made blankets, folding over some more TP, dousing it with glue, and arranging it in a disheveled way so it would have some nice sharp edges when it dried. Pillows were just tiny folded squares of TP. Make these bigger and thicker than you think. I made mine way too thin, and once the glue hit them, they collapsed into nothing. I had to fluff them up so they would look decent when dried. Hot take alert. As a general rule, I think chairs aren't worth crafting for tabletop gaming. Anything approaching a realistic design will be so small and light, and the pieces so thin, like this piece of garbage, that it will be basically useless. In, say, a tavern brawl, you're gonna set up rooms with some tables, stand the various miniatures around their respective tables, and then play out the encounter. Chairs will get in the way, can't be interacted with by miniatures with big wide bases in any meaningful way, and will break easier than prop chairs in the aforementioned tavern brawl. So, all that said, I'm building benches or pews. These are pretty versatile. Use them in the church, sitting out on the town square, seats at the dining table, etc. I chose a simple three-piece design, easy to make and easy to expand to be as long as you want. I consider these an exception to my chair rule because they serve a purpose beyond sitting. They'll be the main source of cover and practically the only feature in the main room of the chapel. Once I pieced them together, they felt a little too plain, so I chopped the corners of the backs off, adding some more visual interest. This piece of scrap has been calling to me for weeks, and I finally know what I want to do with it. An altar of some sort for the chapel. This was a rough cut off of a large flat piece of XPS foam, so I had to clean it up a bit first. I used an emery board and knife to smooth out the cut side and square up the edges to make the top. The main body is a slightly narrower block of XPS. I'm still not great at cutting through the thick foam with the flexible blade, so my cuts were a bit wonky and had to be tidied up. For carving the base of the altar, I wanted a woodworking look that I really do not have the vocabulary to describe. It's kind of a wood panel, concentric squares, indented sort of a look. But basically, I just cut straight into the material and then angled more cuts that intersected the first one to remove a wedge of material. Sometimes several passes were required to make the lines intersect. I didn't want to do too much digging out of bits, since there wasn't a lot of room of error, and it would be hard to correct any mistakes on the tiny pieces. To make an elevated lip for the top, I marked off the width of the base and cut inwards at an angle from this line. By starting from the line, this assured that the lower interior edge of the angle would be smaller than the width of the base, and there would be no gap. I made a pedestal for the whole thing from foam core board, giving it an angled edge to match the rest. After that, I etched a diamond shape in the top of the altar by cutting out small wedges in a similar way to the sides. The only difference being I had two angled lines intersecting rather than one of them being straight. Tacky glue worked best for attaching the rim. I didn't trust hot glue's heat around such thin pieces. It might melt. I made sure to remove as much excess glue as possible to avoid obscuring any detail. Up to this point, I wasn't sure if this was going to be a stone or wood piece. I loved the sharpness of the details and thought that it would be lessened by the foil ball, so I decided on a wood texture. This also allowed me to add more artistic lines to the piece. I imagined this as an intricately assembled woodworking project, so the carpenter would have taken the direction of the grain into account. Probably. There's not much to say about the shelf. It's just like the cabinet, but without a door. Make it as tall as you want, add as many shelves as you want. I made it fairly deep so it's less tip-overable, but you could also add some weight with a washer glued or embedded in the bottom. An important step that I often forget is adding little bits of damage to the pieces. Nicks and gashes here and there on anything that's an everyday item. Next comes a coat of Mod Podge mixed with black acrylic ink. Mod Podge's foam hardening and protection is especially important for flimsy pieces like this that will get moved and tumbled around more than the average large piece of static terrain. A fellow crafter also pointed out that the PVA glue-soaked toilet paper tends to reactivate with washes and paint, so I actually gave this a coat of the Mod Podge as well, as that won't reactivate when it's dried. I used the regular recipe for aged wood on most pieces, an overbrush of golden brown followed by a dry brush of fog gray. I actually ended up not doing any washes on most of the old wood because it looked fine without. Perhaps building smaller pieces gives me permission to slow down and do a proper overcoat of the base coat, leaving the recesses black from the Mod Podge. The table got a more comic book look, plain brown base coat, and a dry brush of golden brown. I wanted to try something new with the cabinet, creating variations in the wood by undercoating. The idea is to paint on the variations in a lighter color underneath. In this case, I'm using an off-white. When I cover the whole thing with a base wood color, the white should show through a bit and create highlights. In this case, the highlights turned out too bright. I suspect my problem was using one bright color rather than including a mix of grays. To fix it, I went back with golden brown to ease the transition and hide the most intense highlights, then mixed up a dark brown wash. Since the wash was basically the same color as the plain brown, the highlights were toned down without overly darkening the rest. For the beds, I did a coat of golden brown over the black base coat to make it easier to apply lighter colors. The sheets took about two coats of pure suede to truly hide the Mod Podge that was trying to peek through. For the blankets, I mixed up a touch of black into some bright colors and very carefully applied it. I did not want to try to recover a bold color that spilled over onto the suede sheets. I covered it all with a coat of dark brown wash, which further muted the colors and stained the actual wood. Since I wasn't happy with just one wild experiment, I decided to try my hand at painting detailed wood grain on the altar. I mixed a base coat of a more yellow golden brown and busted out my wet palette. This is a great tool for mixing paint and keeping it from drying out over long periods of time, both important for the subtle and time-consuming process that I was going to attempt. I mixed various shades of brown and added lines along the carved grain. Brown mixed with golden brown, straight brown, brown mixed with red, brown mixed with black. The more colors you add, the more realistic it should end up looking. This took an insane amount of time and thus is very unsuitable for large buildings. Normally, this is the part where I say, don't worry if this looks like it was upholstered with a giraffe's hide, washes will save it. But I wasn't sure if this was gonna work. I used a very small amount of a store-bought brown wash to help bring all the colors together. Basically, everything got a final highlight in suede, with extra focus on the edges of the furniture and the creases in the bedding. The wooden frame of the smaller bed too closely resembled the sheets, so I gave them a dry brush in golden brown to help differentiate the two. Then it was outside for a coat of a matte varnish. One thing to note, these are very light pieces, and you want to get the varnish on all of the sides. But you can't just secure them with tape like you would a miniature to a piece of cardboard. But if the pressure of your spray varnish is too strong, I recommend covering your hands so you can get a hold of each piece and rotate it and get full coverage. There's nothing worse than having a completed work get blasted off your spray surface into some dust, which of course sticks to all the wet varnish. And voila, enough miniature furnitures to make your players go, "Oh my gosh, it's so cute!" What you build really depends on what sort of buildings you have. If you have a large tavern, you'll want more beds and tables. If you have a lot of shops, more shelves and cabinets. But you don't really need that many of each piece. Assuming you don't split the party, or at least don't split and run them simultaneously, how many shelving units are they really all going to be able to see at any one time? Just make enough to set the scene and reuse them as needed. My favorite part of all of this was definitely the altar. Not worth it for large wood pieces, but it's nice to have a variation to use for more important wooden items that I don't want to get lost in a sea of golden brown overbrush, fog gray dry brush. It's always surprising how much a few pieces of furniture can add dimension to a generic building. Furniture can conceal a trap door or be a secret door to a hidden lab or escape tunnel. Cover is always an option, and never forget the power of piling furniture against the door to delay an enemy.
Well, assuming you're all in one piece, I hope you enjoyed that video. If you did, consider giving it a thumb up and let me know in the comments any basic furniture that you think I might have missed. If you found anything particularly helpful, why not subscribe to the channel or share the video with your Dungeon Master? That stuff really helps me out. Thanks for watching and I'll see you next time. I gotta go find all the nails that I threw. I did so many bad takes at the first bit.